Assalamu alaikum, my brothers and sisters. Alhamdulillah, I'm speaking to you from the city of Johannesburg in South Africa, where we are witnessing a beautiful, beautiful Quran contest. Now, it's important for me to address a certain matter for a few moments. Sometimes people say, you know, this is the recitation of the Quran, it's the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why is it that you have a competition? And how can it be possible or permissible to actually have a competition when it comes to the recital of the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Well, this is not a competition, it's a contest. The idea is to try and determine the standard of recitation and to push the bar up as we progress over the years. And this has already happened and is happening, where every time I come, I hear the recitation, I listen to it, I benefit from it, and I realize that younger children are reading in a more correct way than it was a few years back. So it is actually a contest. And for me, the difference between a competition and a contest is that when it comes to competing with one another, then the Quran, we won't say that I'm competing with you, but we will say we are contesting because we would like to determine a grade. And I believe that every religious institution of learning, when they teach their children, no matter what they teach, and when we teach in our institutions where we're teaching religion, at the end of the term or every so often, we have examinations. It's not because we are competing with one another, although there will be a first, second, third, and the marks will be announced, and we will even give prizes sometimes. All that is to determine the standard and to encourage people to actually be giving greater importance to a specific issue. So when it comes to the madrasas that are there, the Islamic schools that are there, we always do have examinations, and we do have someone who came first, someone who came second, someone who came third, for example. And what will happen is we will even give prizes at the end of the year, or we will have a like a prize giving or a speech night, as they call it, a jalsa, whatever else you'd like to call it. All that is to achieve the same thing. So if it is correct for us to do that when it comes to activity regarding the deen in any Islamic institution, then it would be correct for us to do it when it comes to the Quran. You have, for example, a hadith contest as well, which is something that has not yet come to our shores in such a big way, but it is there in various other countries. So you have this beautiful contest where people are learning, people are comparing notes, people are learning from each other, people realize the standards. You know, we think we read very, very well, but when we interact with others from a different part of the world, sometimes in international contests, we realize that we're making a mistake in A, B, and C. So we correct ourselves, and they might learn X, Y, and Z from us. So this is how we would be able to benefit one another when it comes to the Quran and that which is beneficial, even though primarily it's an act of worship. So the recitation of the Quran is an act of worship, but to perfect it, to create an awareness, to encourage people, it's not about the prize, money. It's not about coming first, and it's not about coming first, second, or third. But when someone does come first, we would know that that is a very high standard, that those who didn't come upon that level would have to take a lesson or two, would have to learn something from this particular person or from that particular standard. And this is a very, very good explanation for those who don't understand. I've seen scholars as well who have perhaps said, you know, it's prohibited. How could you have a contest with Quran, with Hadith? And I ask the same scholars, do you have examinations at the end of the year at your institutions? And they would say, yes, we do. Then the question is, well, what's the difference? They say, no, this is Quran. Well, this is also Islamiyat. It's something to do with the deen. So it's a very simple explanation. If it's right for you, it's right for me. But why do we apply double standards? Sometimes it's because we haven't looked at things from a different angle. When I was very young, I participated in an international Quran contest, but when in 1985, actually, in 1985, when I was quite young, I participated in a local contest in Zimbabwe. And I recall it was in the city of Bulawayo. And I was so excited. I was very young. It more than, you know, worrying about coming first, second or third. I was worried about polishing the Quran. You know, when I say polishing it, what I mean is learning it, making sure that your memorization is strong, your intonation is correct, your tajweed is beautiful, and making sure that you've corrected yourself. So what did it do to me? It created this urge or this yearning within me to learn and to improve. So I started listening to Mahmoud Khalil al-Hussari, great sheikh. I started listening to Muhammad Siddiq al-Manshawi and a few others. And I recall I used to imitate Sheikh Mahmoud Khalil al-Hussari almost perfectly when I was 9, 8, 10 years old at that particular time. Why? Because I was so, you know, concerned about the standard. And I definitely did not want to have a low standard. What helped me? Well, there was a contest that was there, and I had to make sure the standards were upon a mark, a certain point. Thereafter, I attended and I participated in the contest in Mecca. That made me work very hard. And again, you know, I wanted to meet the standards. Obviously, I did not come first, second, or third when I was very young. In my initial participation in Makkatul Mukarramah, which was perhaps in 1986, if I'm not mistaken. And what happened thereafter is I took such a keen interest. When I went to Makkah, I heard people read the Quran in the contest. I heard so many different young people. The youngster who came first, I even remember his name right now. His name was Ali Saleh Makwaji. And this was the guy who came first. This was in 1986. And imagine, I remember the name. It shows you that I was impressed. I was young. And I said, wow, I thought I was a good reciter. And I'm nowhere near first, second, third, or fourth, or fifth. So I need to do something about this. And I started learning more. So it wasn't about winning. It was about understanding the level you're on, understanding what you are trying to achieve, understanding that no matter where you are, there will be someone who has a higher standard than yours. Learn from them. And this will actually make a person work. For example, people record at the institutions where they study tahfidh or hifz, for example, the memorization of the Quran. They record how many mistakes were made. They record, okay, this one is a top student, number one, student number two. Why? Why are you giving them grades? For the same reason. It's a contest. That's what it is. It's within a classroom setting, indeed. But there's one who came first, the other one came second, the other one came third. So the whole classroom can know that this is where we're trying to get. This guy really knows what he's talking about. So when he is reciting, everyone should listen, keep quiet, and try and emulate, try and copy what he is or how he's reciting. I copied Sheikh Khalil al-Hussari. I recall, you know, if you ask me to recite, if I see any one of you asking me to try and imitate what I recall from when I was young, I probably would do it here and now on this live session, subhanAllah. But the point being raised is a very, very important point, that in the same way we have a classroom setting, we have a Darul Uloom setting, we have a university setting, we have a masjid, for example, halaqa setting. When we test one another, why are we testing each other? In order to be able to correct ourselves, to improve ourselves, to be able to achieve a standard, you know. So this is important. And this is why later on, when I participated in 1998, when I participated in the Quran contest for the last time in Makkatul Mukarramah, I was actually fourth in the world for the entire Quran. And I remember that time, it wasn't about being first, second, or third, but I was so happy that by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I worked hard. There was a stage when I used to read one full Quran a day. You know, it might sound strange, but I was a student and I was so dedicated to try to make sure that my hifz was powerful. I didn't want to make a single mistake in the Quran. So I used to read this from the morning to the evening. I used to barely talk to anyone, and I used to read this Quran. Why? Because I really wanted to improve myself. It wasn't about competing with the others. I don't even remember who they were. But what I do remember is, yes, I took part, and alhamdulillah, I'm so happy with the result of what happened. Because today, I'm reaping the fruits of the hard work through those years. So my brothers and sisters, what you need to know is You've got to work hard. No matter what you want to achieve, you have to work hard. But at the same time, what you need to know is we need to encourage each other. We need to make sure that each one of us helps the other identify the points of strength and the points of weakness within us in order to be able to improve ourselves, not in order to bash, not in order to, you know, pick on you, not in order to say this guy doesn't know, this guy's this. No, the idea is to improve the other person as well. So I want to improve, but I want to improve others. I will identify the good points and I will highlight them. Mashallah, very well done, etc. And I will highlight some of the mistakes and I'll say, you know what, that's an error. And I know people who feel bad when you correct them. Subhanallah. So you might have people who say, sorry, to have a Quran contest is wrong. That is their view. They may stick to it. But to be honest, they have not considered it from all angles. And they are doing it in their own context. Whether it's a classroom setting, like I say, they have first, second and third. And I challenge them to cancel all of that. Don't ever say this one was first, this one was second, this one was third. Just don't even have exams. What's the point? You know, unless you want to just say pass and fail. That's it. And stop there. But to actually grade people, that's what a contest is all about. We're grading. So just like you have grades, you know, A grade, B grade, that's how we would have it in a contest. And the reason why I actually am gone live here right now on this particular topic is because there are people who are creating a bit of mischief. There's no harm in having an opinion, but there's harm in actually spreading hate against the other opinion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. I've just explained to you my own benefit from that, and inshallah in that particular way you will be able to understand where I'm coming from. Okay, so my brothers and sisters, that was as far as the message I had for you today goes. If you notice, I went live earlier from the venue of the contest. We're on a break at the moment. I will be going back there just now, and there goes, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I hope to see you in a few hours' time. We will be going live again with the finals of the South African National Quran Contest, by the will of Allah. It's the 12th one. So the 12th National Contest. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for every one of us. I'm going to take one or two comments inshallah now. Maybe a question or two if possible. And then I will close by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is someone, Sister Rumana, saying, I agree, I was also thinking about this. That is a beautiful observation, my dear sister. Like I'm saying, you know, we grade people, even in your classroom, you grade for Quranic studies, for Islamic studies, you grade the students. That is a contest. Please pray for Syria. Indeed, we are bleeding. I tell you what, my brothers and sisters, regarding what's going on the globe, Syria, especially Ghouta these days here, may Allah grant them ease. Get up at night, forsake your bedding, cry to Allah, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection, and for those, and for all of us, and for others who are struggling, perhaps whom we don't know, and ask Allah, and weep to Allah, and cry to Allah, because I promise you, it will make a very big difference. We are helpless in a lot of cases. Look at Kashmir. Someone is saying, pray for Kashmir. Indeed, get up, forsake your bedding slightly before the time of Salatul Fajr and cry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I promise you, you will see results. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease and goodness, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Everyone has a different reciter who they consider top reciter. So when you only go for voice, you may choose a reciter whose pronunciation is not as grand, but his voice is really grand. If you were to go only for a pronunciation, you might have someone who you love, whose intonation might not be that grand, but they're definitely good in pronunciation. And if you go for both, then perhaps you may benefit from the best of both. But you need to be one to recognize one. So if I want to recognize a top reciter, I need to be a top reciter myself. It's easy for people to say, that's a good reader, but they're just hearing the voice. That's an interesting point as well. Okay, my brothers and sisters, I've decided to end this particular session by making mention of the comment by Arnie193, who says something derogatory. My brother or my sister, Arnie193, I can tell you something very interesting. When you use low words and cheap words, you have used them, not us. So it says more about you than it does about us. So I think may Allah bless you, grant you ease. You might be struggling in some way for you to become so nasty. You know, when people are filled with hate, it's because of a problem they have. They might have issues within them. They might have issues of the past. They might have some form of stress on their mind that has made them become filled with hate. So they start uttering dirty words and they start referring to people as dogs and pigs and, you know, baboons and whatever else. They use derogatory terms, you know, big swear words and so on. It's a sign that the person needs help because they're speaking about themselves, not about the other person. If I've carried myself very respectfully, it would definitely mean that I'm a respectable person. I respect myself and therefore I would definitely be respecting others. But if someone hasn't done that, don't drop your level of goodness because of the level of bad of someone else. And that's a piece of advice I've always given. So my brothers, my sisters, let's take it easy. There is another brother here. His name is Farhad. He's also used a term that is so low that he shows what he has learned over the years, how he's been brought up, and you know what he stands for. Such cheap terminology is not what we stand for, my beloved brother. May the Almighty forgive you. And as for us, we've held nothing against you because we didn't use those terms. It's yourself who needs a little bit of help. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you that help. And we will also try our best not to spread hate in the face of hate, but to spread love in the face of hate so that we can rectify the issues that we are struggling with across the globe at the moment. Too much of misunderstanding, too much of lack of education, you know, lack of understanding, knowledge. I'm talking of the dini knowledge as well. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you all. There is someone saying, I respect this. Indeed, we have to. We respect everyone and we understand that people who say cheap terms, they're not talking about anyone besides themselves. I mean, there is someone else, Koros, someone called Brother Koros, saying something. It's the stereotyping, should I say. We excuse you. We will always say good words, even for you. We will pray that the Almighty bless you, grant you goodness, open your doors, and protect you from evil. When I say protect you from evil, that evil includes the evil of the devil. You know, I've met a lot of people. A lot of the times the prayer I make for them is, may the Almighty protect you and bless you. Protect you from what? From evil. If Allah has protected you from the devil and from shaitan, you're going to become a better person. You're going to turn towards the guidance. You're going to become a guided person. So there's nothing wrong with that dua. The people are alive. Make dua for them. Come on, pray for them. Have a good supplication. Say something good. And you know what? The Almighty hears you. Why should I say such a derogatory term if it is the moment of acceptance of prayer? Imagine my derogatory term or my bad prayer for someone would actually become accepted, for example, and I would affect someone negatively. I'd rather seize the opportunity to do something good. It's like if a genie were to come to you, it's not going to happen. But if a genie were to come to you and say you have three wishes, some of the guys will say, right, destroy this guy, kill that guy, and break the bones of that guy. That's it. Your three wishes are gone. Why don't you make a good prayer? Why don't you have three good wishes? You know, something lovely that, okay, all my enemies, convert them into really, really great people who we can all get along with and we have a lovely, lovely understanding, etc. Come on. That's a powerful prayer. There is another person saying Coffee Paddy, talking about himself again. And there is someone else there called Atina. Using the wrong emojis. You know, it's a mistake. It's something that we won't drop to because we've been raised and brought up upon very high levels. Anyway, I've got to go, but I'll see you guys later, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.